forfeit their seats. But it doesn't mean that, that even though that they assume cabinet positions, doesn't mean that there is no coexistence between the legislature and the executive. So it is like obvious or palpable from coming from the parliamentary system, in which it is obvious that members of the parliament come from members of the parliament are members of the cabinet at the same time. But what I'm pointing out is that we should not have some degree of rule for political parties to dominate in that political sphere. And then even though that the legislators assume cabinet positions, it doesn't mean that there is no fusion of powers. Having a semi-presidential system means that there is a limited separation of powers, meaning that the executive that the one part of the executive branch is cooperative with the legislative branch, while the other is independent. But it doesn't mean that we should technically make the executive composed of members of the parliament. We have to have like an arrangement, a percentage arrangement. Yeah, we could at least have 50% of arrangement of cabinet members coming from the legislature, and the 50% of cabinet members coming from outside the legislature. So we don't actually have to rely on the ability of the members of parliament, regardless of their expertise or regardless of the agreement that their political parties have made. That's much more obvious in Denmark, wherein coalition government is very common feature. But I would say that we need to have non-legislators, like non-experts, professionals who would give their advice or give their expertise to the Prime Minister and also to the President regarding policy. A policy matter such as foreign and domestic. Now, the history of semi-presidential, if you know, does not derive from the Weimar Republic or the Finland during the early 20th century. From what I know,
thank you very much, Mr. Yuriel Astillero. Your 5 minutes is already up. I will now be giving an opportunity for the other debaters to question or to give your arguments.
Okay, where should I begin? When it comes to the semi-presidential system, you have a system wherein I'm assuming that the president has little to no power in the sense of being in a state of head of government or something in the sort, whereas most of the power is being utilized by the cabinet ministers or the government in the parliament. So what is the role of the... Because we're seeing like a ceremonial type of president, if we're thinking about this correctly. And then we're seeing him as only an executive power, as in like he's only there to execute the certain laws, he's only there to sign things and he can veto things, I'm assuming. So in this scenario, does this semi-president, I'm saying semi-president because our president has more power than this guy is, supposedly. Does this guy have a voice? Does this guy have an influence over the running of parliament itself so that he could execute laws that are in his favor? If so, that would trigger a form of deadlock or a form of constitutional crisis, as they would say. And it would be a kind of idea that it would cause a form of tyranny. How would it be avoided in such cases?
Okay, so thank you, Mr. Debater. Ken, Yuriel, you want to answer that question?
Yes, I would like to rebut Ken's statement to the point that in order to make semi-presidential or premier presidential more appealing, we have to have more stringent and flexible checks on the presidential power or the presidential authority. I do not actually like tyranny. I don't like the rule by one person. But if we ever experience a period which is known as cohabitation, in which the president and prime minister come from political parties, and then the solution is that there should be a political agreement. A political agreement as another way of combating or mitigating cohabitation. So And also, in order to avoid habitation, then I would say that the legislative election should go first before presidential election go second. So that the winning candidate for the presidency should know what is the electoral, what will be the electoral results from the legislature, and then he will decide on whether whether he will resign from his political party as mandatory required if under suggestion, and then he will discuss, the president will discuss with the legislators over who will become the prime minister. And also, I would like to emphasize that the presidency, even though it is technically part of the executive branch as head of state, it should be an independent institution itself, much like the Supreme Court, but not technically similar to that of the justices. So what I'm pointing out is that we should have an above politics figure coming from the presidency, like what George Washington did when he became president. He was a symbol of unity, and which is one of the exquisite features of having a head of state. And then I do believe that the president might be promoting some sort of stability and unity, but he should be the important arbitrator. He should be the judge over who is right, kung sino ba yung tama o kung sino ba yung mali, either yung legislature or yung executive. Siya na mag-arbitrate. Pero if in any case na yung laws and statutes ay unconstitutional, edi sa Supreme Court na yun, sa Supreme Court na yung mag-decide, hindi na yung president. So there could be a wide differentiation between arbitration or adjudication when it comes to deciding matters that have inter-branch dispute, all right? So I'm not calling for a strong presidency. I'm calling for a strong but limited presidency, meaning that he should follow what the government do. He should follow what the parliament do. And if the legislature and executive are in gridlock or does not find a common ground, especially during times of emergency, then the president should step in, but only temporarily, not permanently.
Mr. Uriel, time's up already. Okay, so Mr. Ken, do you have any further follow-up question?
Okay, that would be fun.
Okay, how about to the side of Mr. Polon? Do you have any question?
The two executives, since you said that in the Senate presidential system, they are two executives, right?
Yeah, that's right.
So what if may isang unpopular policy na nagawa between the president or the prime minister? Who would take the blame? Since dito sa semi-presidential system, may dalawang executive, pwede mag-point fingers to each other yung dalawa. So how can it happen? So ano masasabi mo dito?
Okay, thank you for the question, John. Regarding what I said about habitation, there should be a political agreement, much like in parliamentary system, in which in which political parties need to find an agreement so that they will pass legislation quickly. But when it comes to semi-presidential system, having a political agreement is essential in mitigating the effects of overlap and confusion of accountability. So let's say that the president makes decisions over foreign policy, all right? Let's say that he makes decisions over foreign policy. But then under the political agreement, the president may only make decisions on foreign policy if the cabinet or the legislature may agree with him. And if the cabinet and the legislature does not agree with him, then he should abide by that decision. He cannot go around and say, I make this foreign policy decision, my decision should be followed. No, that would be a sign of tyranny. And what I'm supporting is that there should be a limitation on the part of the president that if in any case that there is a cohabitation, there should be a political agreement that defines who is responsible for this policy success or failure, or who kung sino ba yung institution or yung political actor na maki-exercise ng power sa foreign or domestic or military policy. And I would deeply in favor that the president may be the supreme commander of the armed forces, but he cannot exercise military power alone. He shall he shall follow the decisions of the defense minister or the defense secretary. And then that could be included in a political agreement if in any case that the president and the prime minister or the legislature come from political parties or coalition in a different way. So yeah.
Thank you very much for that answer. Mr. Polon, do you have any follow-up questions?
Follow-up question. What if, since as you mentioned, kanina, dalawa yung executives, how can you remove an incompetent executive president? Since mas mudali i-remove ang prime minister via motion of no confidence by the National Assembly, let's say France. Pero the president still has to say in the government. So how can you remove an incompetent president in the semi-presidential system?
Okay, thank you for the question. Well, regarding the removal of an incumbent executive position, because incumbent executive president, there are many ways. First, there's an impeachment. Impeachment can be carried out either by a legislature or by the ombudsman. And what I'm suggesting is that there should be a flexibility over how impeachment is conducted. So let's say that impeachment cases are initiated by the lower house legislature, and then once the lower house passed that resolution, then that case should be decided not by the Senate, but also by a designated court of impeachment, as will be decided by the Supreme Court. So what I'm saying is that impeachment is not only political but also judicial. And then we cannot just trust the legislature to do their job in removing the incumbent executive president, because that could add up a political flavor in that process, and that could add up partisanship or politicization, as we have seen in Donald Trump and Democratic Congress. So what I'm suggesting is that we have to make our impeachment procedures flexible, right? And a simple majority for the lower house, and also for the designated court of impeachment, conviction should be decided by a simple majority. Also, a simple majority. Because when it comes to supermajority, I do not like that there could be two-thirds or three-fourths. That could be a very obstacle for that process on removing the president. And second, another way to remove the president is filing a case made by an ombudsman or inspector general. So this could be a simple process. The ombudsman will file a case, and then that case will be heard or decided by the court of impeachment. So, right? Because I do not actually like the way that the upper house in the presidential system would do when they are convicting as chief executive. So there you have it. I pointed out two ways on how to remove an incumbent executive president. First, impeachment with flexible procedures, and the second, filing of a case by an ombudsman. That's
it. Okay, so thank you very much, Mr. Astillero. So now we have here the side of semi-presidential. We will now move to the side of constitutional monarchy by Mr. Ken Andre Gerobiese. So Mr. Ken, you now have the floor.
Good morning. I take the stand on behalf of constitutional monarchy, ceteris paribus. To begin my argument, we must at least address monarchy's tour of duty as a dominant model of government for 7,422 years from Sumer to present day. This almost unbroken stability that keeps coming back to such a system continues to baffle modern man, who has fought revolutions overthrowing them in favor of more enlightened forms of government. Among the opposition as well rests the liberal ideology, which finds monarchy preposterous. It is these same people who this morning came to defend a system of government that would not have begun without the king calling on his nobles to bindingly address certain issues, an invention of Mother Spain in 1187, when the Cortes of Leon, still active today, begat the modern parliament. Their binding authority, however, flowed through him, rather than merely being a separate body with their own authority. Such was Parliament until the Magna Carta of 1215, when the King John I of England gave them the power to decide the budget, to his balance. Plebeians eventually gained the right of representation in 1352 when they met independently from the barons, thus creating the bicameral model of parliament we know today. The whole system in this regard could not have existed without monarchy. Parliament would not have any authority and power without monarchy, and parliament could not exist without monarchy. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much. Any other rebuttal or support statement? Calling Mr. Yuriel, okay? You now have the floor.
Okay, regarding the nature of the parliamentary system, I do fully agree that the legislature should be supreme over the affairs of governing the state. But I must say that I don't actually like the concept of parliamentary supremacy or sovereignty to the point that it would imply that the legislature will do whatever it wants or will do whatever it takes. So I truly believe that there should be a rule of law. There should be checks and balances on the power of the legislative and executive that would balance or ameliorate the power of the legislature to pass laws and to execute laws, if in any case that the executive is composed of members of parliament. Because I truly believe in a principle of separation of powers, but not in its absolute form that is found in presidential systems. I truly believe that there should be a retained role for the judiciary, especially the Supreme Court, to invalidate laws passed by the parliament or the legislature if they think that they go beyond the constitution or that they are contrary to the constitution. So you could say that this is my support statement, but I'm supporting for not Westminster system, but also a consensus-type parliamentary system. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much. Mr. Ken, how will you answer that?
Well, in a sense, we can understand his point by summarizing it somewhat as a sort of question of a counterbalance or a co-equal counterbalance to the parliament, because I also agree that the parliament should not be supreme. However, if a president were to do so, we run the risk of him having the same vested interests as the parliament, and so you have the same problem as can be found in semi-presidential models of cohabitation, wherein the votes will be the one counting, or like certain political factions will be the one counting for what laws get executed. For these reasons, a constitutional monarchy works perfectly as a solution for these problems.
Okay.
Why?
I'm sorry, Mr. Ken. 2 minutes. You reach already 2 minutes. So, Mr. Yuriel.
Okay. 4 points. Firstly, a royal family and the nobility directly profit from a beneficial social order in the form of property values, which increase through better living standards. Secondly, a royal family and the nobility hold their positions hereditarily because of their lineage of ancestors who performed active duty in both civic and or military affairs, not just because they were born into aristocracy. Third, a royal family and the nobility exist as a co-equal threat to the parliament. Both parliament and the firm have sovereign power, but the state apparatus only swears loyalty to one group. This credible threat gives them an incentive to act properly and in the interest of the people who genuinely reflect the profits of the firm. And lastly, a royal family and nobility exist as a political constant. You do not choose them. This means that they are far removed from the vested interests of individual citizens, their votes, and their parties. And the decision to execute the will of the people will not be impeded by bias, whether of a political or a patronizing nature. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yuriel. You are raising your hand.
Okay. I do understand about your monarchical or royal stance, but given our history, our past history as Filipinos, we do have kingdoms though. There is a kingdom of Tondo, there is a Sultanate of Sulu. But do you really think that we can be united as a kingdom under one one family from a single race or ethnicity, it is, I would say it is entirely impossible. I would fathom that it's impossible for us to have a monarchy in the present day, because we do have a monarchical history, yes. But do you really think that we can be united as a monarchy? That there could be a Filipino monarchy or Filipino royal family or Ilocano royal family or a Bicolano royal family or Ilocano royal family or Taustig or Sul or Sulu royal family?
Thank you very much, Mr. Yuriel.
I would say it's impossible.
2 minutes is up. So, Mr. Ken, do you have any rebuttal or answer?
I came into this debate with a condition that we were not going to discuss this because I said that in the beginning that we're only debating systems. All of this is ceteris paribus, meaning that we're not going to talk about the local conditions for now. We're just talking about the systems as it is. So we're talking about the merits and demerits of certain systems. We're not talking about how we're going to concretely implement these systems. As for, let's say, this is just a hypothetical, we already have these kinds of familial relations in the Philippines in power in the current day, which we elect democratically. They are in the form of dynasties who were there even during the Spanish period. So we can't exactly say that there are no ways where we can implement monarchy in the Philippines, but I do not believe that there is a right way to do it either, which is why I try to distance myself from the practical question of implementing a constitutional monarchy. We only agree and disagree on the subject of the systems, not on the practical necessity of it. Thank you.
Okay, so Mr. Polon is raising his hand.
Since you are advocating for monarchy, I would like to ask, what family would be the ruling dynasty of the hypothetical kingdom of the Philippines?
Once again, Mr. Bulon, we are talking in ceteris paribus. This means all things being equal. We will not discuss the practical aspects, meaning who will be the next monarch or whatever. We're talking about and assessing the system. We're not talking about who will be the next king. We will not be talking about where they'll come from, what ethnicity, whether it will be implementable here. We're just talking about we're weighing the benefits, the cost and benefits of each system. Thank you.
Since you mentioned cost and benefits, you cannot divorce the practical side of the topic, since you cannot just base on hypothetical, but rather you need to focus more on the practical, the scenario of the monarchy itself. You need to apply the applicability to the Philippine people. Kasi if you not, magkakaroon ng backlash, lalo na sa, with the nationalist itself.
Well, then,
okay, Mr. Ken, you have the option to answer that or not, since the question is speculative.
Okay. Let's then, if you insist, talk on the practical necessities of this thing. First, we just elected a monarch with 31 million votes. He comes from a dynasty whose kingdom rests upon the murder of 10,000 people. We already have ensured that his line is in power. His nobles are loyal to him. By this point, we are just consenting the government. We have no actual power here. We accept them now. In this situation, if he, our current president, were to become king, he has a legitimate claim to the throne in this stead, because trial by combat, he definitely is going to be king. However, in this case, we're going to talk about all of these specific points. We're going to see that all of them is going to be a problem, because the last time that their family was in power, we already know that their profitability went above and beyond what was already given to them, even with a parliamentary system in place. Their family was in power, they already had a parliamentary system in place. We were already in the cusp of monarchy anyway, but we've seen the terrible devastation that it would be given them had they taken power. So how about the opposite? We also know that in the more yellow ideas of who should be the one in government, even then we see that they have been the suspects or the primary perpetrators of massacres. Many coup attempts against their family have happened in their reign. So in this point, we have two separate families by which we can objectively claim that they can form a constitutional monarchy. But in both sides, we're at a dead end, because in both practical ways, they have done nothing but destroy our country, even with the necessary safeguards in place.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Yuriel is raising his hand.
Okay, this is my last question. Okay, so as much as I understand your stance on monarchy, how would you make your position on constitutional monarchy distinguished or different from that of the constitutional monarchies that you have passed, especially in the United Kingdom and Spain, and also absolute monarchies such as Tsarist Russia, Morocco, Saudi Arabia? How do you could you give us a model as to or could you persuade us as to why do we have to move to constitutional model? Like how do we adapt to the monarchical standards if we let our republican ideas to go down and be dead?
Well, for one thing, there is two arguments for in terms of difference. Firstly, we will be following the Asian model of monarchy wherein, firstly, in terms of the succession, we don't immediately go after the firstborn son, whereas in the Western countries they do. In the Eastern countries, we have a system wherein after the demise of a monarch, the dowager widow would take power before the baron would personally elect or personally ascend another monarch. Secondly, in the East Asian model system, we have plenty of examples. For example, in Japan, wherein their constitutional monarchy is based on a dietary system, wherein they have a cabinet as their substitute. Whereas in the UK monarchy, that's only a ceremonial position, wherein like you just ceremonially hand over government to the next cabinet. The cabinet in a dietary system is actually separate, but coming from the parliament body. And then in one of the comments, they suggested the rotating monarchical system as per in Malaysia, which is not true. They elect their monarchs from among themselves. In the Malaysian model, it wouldn't exactly work because in their system, they would have to be... For what? They have a system wherein this monarch is given a what? What's that? One over equal, something like that. One above the equal status. All of them still regain a form of power, but then it only flows through them. So the entire thing is essentially a sham government in Malaysia. However, so I wouldn't exactly say theirs would be a great system either. In our system as well, there is a different way of doing things, wherein the monarch is expressly having a direct executive role. That is different from most other monarchies, wherein the monarch is only there to sign papers and wave at people. In our monarchies, he is literally the chief executive. Such a monarch means that he directly goes ahead and does things. He does the things that is given to him by parliament. He does the dirty work of government. Whereas we decide what needs to be done, he does what needs to be done. That is what a monarchy is supposed to do. When we have an active monarch, a co-equal active monarch with co-equal power and co-equal authority, you have the power to maintain stability in society and the even flow of resources across people, which creates a better system insofar as everywhere else than the rest of the world's constitutional monarchy.
Okay, thank you very much. Actually, you're already way over time, but Mr. Yuriel, do you have any follow-up question?
No.
Okay, Mr. Okay, Mr. Polon.
So you also, I have a question now. Okay. So yeah, you said that the monarchy, you know, you said you wanted a potential monarchy. However, the family of, you know, the families in the Philippines, kasi before the Spanish arrived, hindi, you know, we're not united as a whole. Kung magkakaroon man tayo ng constitutional monarchy, we have to go back to the Spanish roots since sila naman yung nag-unite sa atin. However, it could cause backlash against those nationalists who are against the Spanish colonial. I'm not dense. See, in Pina question, sino ba yung monarch? Is it us or we're going back to the Spanish or them?
Okay, Mr. Ken.
Well, I hope this is the last one. In the system that I try to implement, it isn't in any way Spanish at all. In the sense of the Spanish monarchy, you have a hereditary monarch with, I guess, a reformed Salic law because of the liberal reforms. So it's still a Western model. In our system, we have I call the system as a law by peer review, wherein every single legislator and every single political person in power are those who review something that is already making its way to being law, rather than a system wherein we have representatives that make things into law. After all, the judge is the one that decides the sentence.